Hello! Hello!
Wow, he's got something.
There we go.
That
was good in there, but I love that. Our camera guys don't have any gear. Okay, we, I know it's a lovely day, and we're sad to come inside, but we can do it on a spread. But we are here for the Tuesday, September 28th work session. So I'm going to officially call that to order. On item two is citizens' comments. That is reserved for items that are not on the agenda. And so if you've got something you want to talk about not on the agenda, we'll be glad to listen for a short period of time. And if not, we'll move on to item number three. Yes?
I have something I want to ask you. Because it was my understanding after the last meeting that we did not get to that access road out there on Mac Hatcher. We also did not get to the sidewalk issue, and that is not on the agenda tonight.
The access road is on the
sidewalk issue is
Some of the staff involved in that item on the sidewalks aren't here tonight.
Okay.
And so we're going to move that to the first meeting in October.
That's fine.
So we'll get to it, but the folks who had the background aren't available to us.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? All right. Item number three, flood mitigation program report.
I'll make this very quick. Really, the only thing to update at this point is the ongoing hazard mitigation grant program process that we are in. We have opened up the public process in terms of individual residents indicating at least an initial statement or indication of interest in participating in the grant program. And so we launched that last week. We had a public meeting in this room attended by about 28 to 30 residents who came to that meeting, presented that to them. We have the open process for folks to indicate their interest between now and October 25th. To date, we've received eight submissions by our residents indicating they might be interested in participating. Of that group of eight, we estimate that five or six of them are in the substantially damaged category. So I think that's a pretty good start for the 1 week into it, and we'll continue to have that available to folks and give them the opportunity to submit and indicate their initial interest in the program. All of the information and forms related to participation on the program are on our website at franklintn.gov. You can just click on there. Right on the front page, there's a link right to the Hazard Mitigation Grant Program. There's also an ongoing button that's been on there, will be on there for the foreseeable future related to flood response, and you can click there in either way. One of those buttons, you'll get right to this and get the information, background information, all the forms that you need to fill out. There's really one primary form that we're looking for at this point. It's called a questionnaire, but it also includes an initial statement indicating you're interested in participating in the grant program. So that's where we are, and again, the deadline is October 25th for residents to indicate their initial interest in the grant program.
October 25th. Yeah. Beth?
When you said five or six are substantially damaged, does that mean over 50% then?
Yeah, the definition is 50% of the structure.
Still
the repair cost is 50% or more.
Okay.
Yes. Which is a FEMA definition.
Right. Okay.
Anybody else? Okay. Item number four.
I have to say what it is.
Sorry.
He's so excited. Rahinsky's up there ready to go. He's got a tie on and looking nice.
What color is that?
Presentation from the Franklin Police Department Crime Reports Analysis Tool. There we go. Now you
come on forward. Assistant Chief Rahinsky is going to give you a presentation on this, but what we want to show you tonight is an example of another application of technology. And technology is a more and more part of all of our lives, but also, and not limited to, what we do in law enforcement. And law enforcement has an application for the police side, but also for our partnership and working with citizens. And you've seen that in what we do with Facebook and Twitter and Nixel and what we do on the website and all those kind of things. And this is an online resource that we want to show you tonight. And I'll let David take you through that.
Thank you. Good evening. This is a new initiative that we've undertaken. It dovetails well with October's National Crime Prevention Month. This new website that we're unveiling tonight to the public has both a public application and an application for law enforcement. And I'm going to give you a very brief overview of both sides of it. It is live now, so anyone watching or anyone when you get home tonight, if you're interested in accessing the site, that's the address. It's very simple, crimereports.com. Again, the social network portion will give the public crime statistics and as well as the ability to map them. For us, it provides greater analytical tools, and I'll give you a brief overview of what those are. If you go to the website, this is what you'll initially see. If you click on the state of Tennessee, you'll see in the drop-down boxes, City of Franklin. Click on City of Franklin. And it'll give you, initially, it gives you the ability to select the crime or the date, and then it applies it to the map that you see in front of you. The map will auto-populate. If you look in the upper left-hand corner, you can either sort by crime or by date, different time frames, 7, 3, 14, or 30 days. And you can also pick the crime type. And if you're interested, you can click that box there, which will populate the sexual offenders in the city as well.
This is still public.
This is still the public side, yes. This is all public information. If you click on an incident that has been mapped, it provides you with the details, and that's not particularly clear. But on your computer screen, what you would see is that's a breaking and entering. It gives you the address. It gives you the distance from the address that you entered as your home address. We entered the police station, so it shows us it's 1.49 miles from home. It gives you the ability to share it with a friend. So if you're on a homeowners group or you want to send it to your alderman because you've got questions about it, you just have to click on that. This is where you can sign up for email alerts regarding crime. If you enter your home address in the upper left-hand corner, here you pick the type of crime that you want to be advised of. You can select all of them. And in the bottom, you select the radius. It goes from a half mile up to 5 miles. So the beta version, which is 2.0, which will be out sometime next month, actually gives you the ability to draw around your neighborhood. And it, instead of being a radius map, will give you the diameter that you select. Now we're going into the police side. This is the same 30-day snippet. Here you see we've got four geographic zones in the city. This is the crimes, and although it's very small there and hard to read, those are each crime occurrence by type. This is the crime by the day of the week and the hour of the day, and this is just the day itself. That's 30 days worth of occurrences that you see there. That's everything. That's crime, that's traffic, criminal traffic offenses, and misdemeanors as well. Here on the left-hand side, it gives us the type of crime it is. We have the ability to click on there, and then it populates the narrative, so we see exactly what the report said. This is a little sophisticated for us, but we're working with it. It gives us a four-month baseline. Gives us a standard deviation and then shows us whether we're up or down for the period of time that we're looking at. So once we figure out what standard deviations are, we'll use that.
Anne can explain it.
Yes, I'm using that right now.
You still won't know what it is when she gets done, but she can tell you what it is.
I hope you got better eyes so you can see the numbers.
I can see one of them.
This is, again, just the police side. Actually, everything from here on out is just the police side. These are the four zones that we have in the city geographically. Here's the crimes, and this is it for this specific two-week period. Here I'm comparing 4 weeks ago, that two-week period, to the most recent two-week period. You can see here on the left-hand side, those are the numbers for theft, although the printing's a little small, theft from vehicle, assault, property crimes, and even quality of life crimes, which are down here. Not crimes, but quality of life calls for service. This is the current two-week period. This is really unique, and we're looking to implement this. What we want to do is we want to be able to take our resources and deploy them not only where the problems are, but historically where the problems have been. This is a very simplistic illustration, because what this is the retail thefts. Right. We queried retail thefts just to illustrate if we didn't know the area and we didn't know anecdotally where our retail thefts come from, this would show us. That's the mall. That's an obvious hot spot. You can see downtown where some of the businesses are. But that's a retail theft map that's drawn historical data and populated for us into a hot spot map.
So you can do that for any?
We can do that for any type of crime and for different crime, different crime types and different range dates, so. And ultimately, what we'll be doing is we've got four lieutenants in the operations division. Each lieutenant will be responsible for a given zone. They'll be responsible when we meet bi-weekly to tell us the activity going on in that zone, if crime's up or down. If in fact it's up, recognizing what's driving the numbers and working to deploy the department's resources to address those problems while they're in their infancy. Any questions? Well, thank you very much.
Can I, go ahead.
I just want to know, how soon are the crimes posted on that map after the report?
It dumps information every 24 hours.
So
what you're looking at today is a recent up to yesterday.
Okay, so it wouldn't be on there like within 2 or 3 hours or 12?
No.
Usually 24?
24 hours.
Okay,
and then when you said the maps include all crimes and in misdemeanors, does that include traffic citations as well?
It only includes criminal traffic, DUI type offenses.
Okay.
If it's a criminal traffic offense, it does show up.
And then when you said it also indicates call for service, when you say that, give me a couple examples of what call for service would be. I'm thinking,
right.
But I was wanting to hear what you said.
Anything that we capture with a written report, it'll populate when we do the proper query. What we're looking at is, I want us to be able to retrieve, say we go to a domestic dispute and say we've been to the same house 3 or 4 times mm-hmm. in a 6-month period.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than maybe one shift be aware of it or different shifts handling those calls, I want us to be able to recognize that there's an emerging problem, maybe get them social service help. But address problems that we otherwise may have missed. Mm-hmm. If there's a call, a noise complaint that happens maybe more regularly than it should, instead of going on a Saturday night when the problem's occurring, we can make it a point to go and speak to parents, you know, during the day and tell them, look, we've been here 3 times in 3 months. We need to address this issue now rather than waiting for the next phone call.
Do the policemen themselves fill out their, this is how they're filling out their crime report now, is on this statistical data, or do they is it a duplicity? Do you have to do it several times?
Actually, it doesn't duplicate the process. They're doing exactly what they've always done. What this system does is it draws from our RMS, our records management system, and populates their web-based program with our information.
Okay.
This program cost us $3,000 to participate in, so it's a really low cost tool.
That's amazing.
And the greatest benefit is really, we love sharing it with the public, what we can so that people are informed, but the police side is really what's gonna help us with the allocation of resources and how we manage what we do every day. And the whole management team is gonna have a great tool, I think, to work with going forward.
As recently as a few years ago, this type of information would have taken an analyst a full-time job. The fact that for $3,000 we get this information and can keep the citizenry informed and deploy our resources smartly, it's a great investment.
Yeah.
Thank you.
David, if you go back to the one where you showed everything.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, that's a mess.
keep in mind,
scary.
That's a 30-day period, and that's mm-hmm. everything, including all our misdemeanors, all our quality of life calls that get written down, noise complaints, anything that generates a written report is captured there.
It's activity. It's not necessarily crime.
Right.
Okay, so that's important to make that distinction. But it's information that will be helpful.
It's cat and tree calls, too.
Yeah. It's a little bit of everything.
We'll respond to about 70,000 calls for service this year, and anything that generates a written report will populate the system. Then we've got the ability to manipulate the system and draw the crime out from the issues that we really don't need any additional attention.
Mm-hmm. In the big picture, Franklin is very fortunate. We have one of the lowest crime rates in the region, in the country. But our partnership with our citizens is important, and analyzing our trends is important so that we stay that way. And that's the genesis behind this.
Yeah, well, this map also basically tells us and shows us that our policemen are doing their jobs. They're out there responding to the calls. They're putting in their reports, and we can see, exactly what's happening.
It's a good point, because this also includes self-generated calls. If our officers go out and do a traffic stop that results in a DUI arrest, or a traffic stop that results in a narcotics arrest, it'll be captured here. And the FBI just released the crime statistics, the uniform crime reports for 2009. We had a significant decrease in violent crime last year. We had a slight increase in property crime, and it was mostly in-custody retail thefts at our commercial establishments.
Okay, David, thank you. Appreciate it. Item number five, consideration of software annual renewal agreement with Hewlett Packard in amount of $72,989 for the city's Wi-Fi access points. This was deferred on Bowman 914. It's on tonight's agenda. So, questions, comments, concerns? Seeing none, we'll move on to item number six, consideration of professional service agreement with Kleinert Engineering, or is it Kleinert? It's Kleinert, I'm sorry. Engineering Associates for the design of the McEwen Drive at Wilson Pike Intersection Improvement Project.
Take it. This is a follow-up from last meeting. So.
Let's see if there's any questions, comments, concerns.
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
First of all, I kind of wanted to know, what's your general rule of thumb for the design fee as a percentage of the construction? Of the project.
It could be anywhere from 5 to 10, maybe even upwards of 20%. We talked about this a little bit last time. Because of the inclusion of CSX Railroad, dealing with TDOT, a lot of coordination to deal with. I can't remember what this percentage comes out.
It's approximately 10.
It's 10. I mean, anything in the 10% range is pretty standard. For this, with the things that it's dealing with, it's very acceptable.
And the other thing is, I noticed that there was a project schedule, but how long would it take construct? And, you know, it says advertise for bid, so I assume you can't start construction for at least, 3 months after that? And so what time is projected for the construction? Because it looks as if we're moving into the school year, or easily moving into the school year, the 2012 school year.
Well, the exact construction schedule won't be decided until we actually get into design. But anytime you talk about a bridge, bridges take a lot longer to construct. A minimum of 12 months. Coordinating with CSX could add some time to it. So I would estimate somewhere between 12 and 18 months for construction.
After you get the bids.
Yeah.
After you award the bids, really.
Yeah. Yeah, it's about 3 months from the time we advertise to the time that we actually start construction, is roughly 3 months, counting mm-hmm. the advertisement, which is about 3 weeks, the amount of time that goes through board approval, and then getting a contractor set up with pre-construction meeting and started about 3 months after that. So you could probably, I mean, worst case scenario, probably 24 months after your bid note or your bid advertisement that's in there in the packet.
So really, that would be the end of the 2014 school year.
I believe so.
Mm-hmm. Because the advertisements is just indicated from May 2012.
Okay. Yeah.
What happens to the traffic? The school traffic while the bridge is being built?
Well, the bridge will be a new bridge. The existing bridge will stay in. Of course, you know, once again, a lot of this stuff will be handled during the actual design of this. The consultant will determine a traffic control plan, but because it's a new roadway, essentially where the bridge is going to be tying into an existing roadway, where the bridge is, the bridge should not affect anything. I mean, you'll have to, where it ties back in, where you put the turn lane on Wilson Pike, it'd be no different than you probably have a occasional lane closures, shifts in the lane, just your standard traffic that you have, or traffic control that you have on most construction projects on existing roadways.
Okay, anything else? All right. Item, thank you, Eric. Item number seven is consideration of the draft 2010 road impact fee study update. And what we're doing tonight just is just sort of developing a list of questions that we want to make sure the engineer has, because we're trying to schedule a work session just on this item. And we've got a couple proposed dates. I don't know if you've all, have we forwarded those possible?
I don't think we have. The 11th or the 14th is what we had talked about. Do you think this still works?
There's not much in October. I looked at the board's, the city calendar, talked with the consultant. 11th and the 14th, I believe, are the only 2 days that really worked for.
11th is a Monday, and the 14th is a Thursday, where you also have the Capital Investment Committee.
Which it could follow up.
Piggyback on that if you wanted to.
I believe there.
Got one Thursday, one Monday.
Well, you're never gonna pick.
Either one.
You have a Monday. Does anybody have a preference for any other day? Does it matter? All right, we'll do Monday.
Monday.
Yeah. Monday the what?
11th.
The 11th.
Monday the 11th.
I'm gone.
Oh, you're gone.
That's when
I'm gone.
You're gone on the 11th, but you wanted the 11th.
That's Monday. The 11th.
I'm gone on Thursday.
Which Thursday?
14th.
Are you gone the
14th? I'm gone.
So it doesn't matter.
I'll be gone on 11.
So you what?
Oh,
you're
gonna be gone on 11.
I don't care. Pick a date. Staff, pick a date. We'll
do it on the 14th.
Whatever.
We get back on the CIP.
Okay. But tonight, just I think briefly, is what we want to make sure is that we, when the consultant comes, that we don't ask him something that he's not prepared for. So if you have specific questions now, we can get them to him, or we can write them to staff. And it might be easier to email them to staff, unless you want to have some conversation about it now. So
I had put my question together, but I hadn't had a chance to write it down until right now. But just what effects, if any, do projects identified in the major thoroughfare plan have on the impact fees?
Okay. And I will write you. I've got 4 or 5. But
okay. Well, when would be a deadline to put those? That was my main.
If you want it in the packet format, I mean, we've got to get the packet out next Thursday, so we'd have to have. We can hand it out at the meeting.
By the end of the week. Would that be?
By the end of this week? That'd
by
be fine.
Friday?
That'd be fine.
Friday? Okay. That's my main.
Yeah, we'll record it.
Yeah.
The other question I had was, Eric, you sent some study of the survey. And it was like 48 pages long, so I didn't print it out. Did I miss something? I didn't notice that we were compared to anybody that we normally compare ourselves to. It was.
Well, we really can't compare ourselves to the people we normally do for like most of our surveys, because not everybody has the impact fees. This is a nationwide. There was only six, if I remember correctly, there was only six responses from the survey request for the road for the impact fees from Tennessee. If you notice, Brent wouldn't adopt.
And do they have? They do have impact fees, don't they?
My understanding is yes.
Okay, because
so they did not. They did not.
Gansville responded.
But can't we find out what they are?
Yeah, we can find out.
Let's find out what they are.
It's like Rutherford County and some other county that would surprise me. You know.
Like Dr. Moore said, it was a long report.
Yes, it was.
There was one page that sort of summarized some of it, and I did print that one page, and that's all I printed of it. So, if you'll notice, we are actually lower than Knoxville.
We'll try to fill in some gaps, though, with ones that we know have it that may not have been captured in that survey, so like a Brentwood. Or
what about Metro? Do they?
I don't believe Metro does.
I didn't. I mean, they weren't on there, but
Germantown may be built out.
No.
I don't think they were on there, were they?
No, you got Laverne, Smyrna, Portland, White House, Franklin, Nolensville. Looks like those are the only tests. Looks like those are the only tests.
I thought there was one that was kind of a strange. I thought there were.
And we need to make sure that on this work session that there's plenty of public notice, because there are interested parties on this one.
Yes, there are. And one thing to keep in mind is, once you decide what you want to do, we have at least a two-reading ordinance that we have to go through to make any changes whatsoever. And there will be a public hearing on that, so.
And I think it would be interesting to know, if it gets reported in the paper, that I think that work session would be a good time to have input from people other than just us. So I would say, if there's developers or builders, anybody who wants to be part of that, that would be the best time for their input while we're having this discussion.
That's the 14th meeting, John?
Whenever that we didn't.
We decided.
We usually only have the ability to say yes or no. When it comes to some other broader decision, we really have a hard time. Okay.
Well, this is going to have several pieces to it.
No, I'm just talking about the date.
I knew what you were talking about. But I was going to say, this has several options here, though.
Yes.
And so that may make it more difficult. But no, I knew you were talking about the date.
Anything else? All right, great, thanks, guys. Item number 8, consideration COF contract number 2010-150, an annual agreement with USGS for Harpeth River Gauging Station operations and maintenance. This is on the agenda tonight. We've talked about this a couple times, haven't we?
We talk about it every year at this time. This is an annual contract. It does change annually as far as how much it is. USGS pays for part of the total cost. We pay more than half. This is for the two gauging stations that we have our wastewater treatment plant and our water withdrawal tied to, that we have to use the information from. So it's not, if you recall, several years ago, we did away with other USGS stations because we didn't have anything tied to them when we started putting in our own. But these, we have our plants tied to through TDEC and all that, so we have to keep them.
Any questions on that?
The cost did go down this year.
The cost did go down.
Item number 9, consideration of a request from David Crabtree for a letter of recommendation for a ride-in, ride-out access to Matt Catcher Parkway, approximately 900 feet east of Hillsborough Road, between the shops at Harpeth Village and the Williamson County Parks and Recreation Complex. And Alan Ramsey's here with Reagan Smith, representing Mr. Crabtree.
This had been a request to you. Obviously, you're not the decision maker. TDOT is. And the request that came to the city and to the county, I think, at the same time, was a request for some sort of letter of support. We specifically asked that there be a traffic study so that there'd be some other data to look at to understand the impact of this as this went forward. And so that's what we've looked at and reviewed in this process. You know, your options really are to do a letter of support, to not do a letter of support, or do a letter that sort of doesn't say you oppose it, you could sort of not take a position on it, I guess. You could indicate that you're not taking a position, I guess, at this point. So I guess we leave that open to you to discuss, and we'll answer any questions you have. And we have the representative who's involved in the traffic study here as well. So
I would add one thing. If you do go forward with a letter of recommendation, I would recommend that we at least make sure that that does not leave out the opportunity for any other access points on Macatcher. We've looked at access at, between Liberty and 96 in the past, which we've never gotten a positive response from TDOT on that. I would hate for TDOT to come back and say, well, we gave you this access, now we're not going to give you any more. So I would at least recommend that we include that in the letter, if we go forward with the letter, to that it doesn't preclude any other access points.
Well, how close is that to the intersection?
800
something.
Something feet.
900.
I don't think there are too many people around now who were here when this thing was done. But when it was designed, it was to be limited access, absolutely limited access. And the only way in the world that the Methodist Church got access was because it was directly across from Spencer Creek with a light. I would be absolutely opposed to even asking TDOT to recommend this. There would be no end to the request that would come for more access. I go to the rec center all the time. I never have had a problem getting out. There's a light there. Day, night, doesn't matter. You can get out at any time. And I would be very much opposed to asking for a recommendation from the state to do this.
Beth?
This access, is it ingress only?
No, it'd be
right in.
But it's only right turns only. Right in, right out.
And the proposal included with the traffic study is for it to be a public road that would connect Lancaster over to Fulton Greer. Just as a side note, when we first had discussions with TDOT, and really the process as we went forward was first talking with the county to get their recommendation and then come to the city of Franklin. We actually looked at the possibility of another right-in, right-out or access going to the south to help the traffic off the school, and the county actually said they did not want to. They didn't want to do that. Mm-hmm. And I believe it was specific to the soccer fields and that sort of thing. But this is just, it's a right-in, right-out that would be that connector between the two.
Now, let me ask you something else. Fulton Greer Lane, right now, I'm trying to remember, every time I go in there, that's the only way in there.
Yes.
It's the only way out.
And the only way in where?
To the rec center. Mm-hmm. Off of Matcatch or
Hillsborough.
It's the only way you can get back to the rec center, correct?
Correct.
Something happened there. We're always talking about access. And we've got a rec center there with people working out all the time. You know how many calls and ambulances and health calls we've had to that center. What if we had some way not, what if something happened up there, we couldn't get into that? You know, I'm just saying, what if? You know, maybe we should think about those things if we're thinking about another access point to the rec center.
Yeah. Well, let us say, though, there are many, many developments, and including many institutions along Matcatcher that do not have a direct access.
Well, not only that, anyone with more than 6 inches of clearance and the willingness to plow down a cow fence can get off Matcatcher and onto that property.
That's the state fence, though. You might go to federal prison if you cut that thing.
I mean, my point is simply that
get an ambulance
as far as emergency service,
they could get through there.
You could get an ambulance for that?
Sure.
I feel pretty sure they could.
Well, as long as you can get an ambulance for there.
If my memory is correct, it wasn't that long ago that we were discussing a right-of-way into, rather off of Matcatcher into Mr. Mitchell's property. And if I remember correctly, that didn't sit well with the board at that time. And I would compare this in a lot of ways to that. And kind of my concept of Matcatcher, it is supposed to be a limited access road. So I would have difficulty supporting this based on what I know about it.
Mayor.
Yes, sir.
I might be able to stomach a right turn off of Matcatcher only, but putting traffic in position to join Matcatcher in a right out causes me considerable concern, even though I have some difficulty understanding why anyone would do that in the first place. I think a previous comment has raised a valid point here, and that is, if we weigh in and lend our letterhead to this request, we will be asked to lend our support to many requests. We don't have the authority to give or not give this access, And I mean, I don't know whether to be flattered or not that the state seems to care what we think, but I just don't think that this is something in which we should meddle, and I'm not sure I would support the result anyway.
Okay, any questions? If not, we'll bring it forward. It will not be on the consent agenda, so.
You mean it's not deemed non-controversial?
It's not deemed non-controversial.
That managed to set off whoever's meter that is?
That's right.
Good.
From the man who wants the meetings to be as short as possible.
I just, like I said, I just one time wondered whose meter it was.
These discussions help that.
How it was being calibrated, what was non-controversial.
We have a, in the back, we actually have a little meter that figures out.
With a hammer.
Whether it's really controversial or not.
It's a false meter.
Yes.
We never get a.
I still can't, you know, get around the fact that if there's something else back there, that's one thing, but I keep looking at this thinking, rec center, thousands of people visit there, all ages. Wonder, I'd like to actually have a report. Find out how many times the fire trucks and the EMS visits our rec center. I'd be very interested in that.
Hey, Rahinsky, does that report that you did that doesn't fire?
Click on that address. And then there's a swimming pool there as well.
The chief's back here. The other chief's back here. Granted, he's got that information.
Well, let's just stop and remember.
Who's asking for it? The owner of the Harper Village Shopping Center.
David Crabtree.
Yeah.
Let's just remember, BGA is just around the bend from this. How many accesses does it have? One. None of which goes directly to Matt Catcher.
Right.
And so if you're talking about, you know, weighing this, unfortunately, I do think that once you start on this, the request would be endless.
All right. Okay. You got, you can report back to Ms. Crabtree. It doesn't look very promising. Item number 10, review and discussion of the FY 2011 water / wastewater rate study. Eric and Mr. Hilton. This will not go on consent either.
This is really the start of a discussion in terms of water and sewer rates. We've presented to the Budget and Finance Committee a amendment of the second year of the budget. If you remember last year, we did a two-year budget for water and sewer and reused water, and are revisiting that with some amendments. But we also need to update our rates for the second year of that budget, and we would like to look out 3 to 5 years in terms of rate structure and where we need to be long term in terms of cost recovery within our utility operations. So this presentation tonight looks at our cost of service overall and lays out some approaches to getting there over time, and we would like to get at least some initial direction from you tonight so that we can build some more specific rate options for a future discussion.
Well, I tried to be all prepared before coming up here, but my computer decided to die on me, so my apologies.
Isn't that always the case?
Yep.
It always is the case.
Maybe the crime report analysis will show that.
People stealing water.
PC death.
Yeah. Bear with me, I apologize.
Well, why don't you introduce your guest?
Yes, I'm sorry.
You can start.
Well, I'm tweaking with this. This is Jim Marshall. He is with Jackson Thornton. They've been working with us for the past several years in evaluating our rates. And this year, as Eric had mentioned, we are continuing through with our rate analyses, and we'll, in the coming weeks and months, be presenting a rate design for you all.
And probably we will have, again, a special water rate work session. But what we need to do is sort of give some inclination as to the direction we're going to take, which will be a little bit clearer when he gets through his report, which will then allow him and Jackson Thornton to to come with some further projections. And so this is sort of the first part of that. And it'll become clear if Hiltic and the same people working on your computer must be working on mine.
Right?
Been gone for 2 days.
Has it?
Yes.
I think I can get through the first three
we
slides.
Can take it. Yeah. At least the board has hard copies.
Yes, we do.
We can get this up on the screen as soon as possible. I'll hand out to you also.
I can hold that up. You can show it.
I'm going to give you also a rate comparison chart that shows some of the other regional utilities, water and sewer, what their current rates are, what the average is of those groups, and what we are at currently in terms of rate for both a minimum bill or availability charge and also a typical usage, which is 7,000 gallons, which is about what our average use is actually slightly below that. But that gives you a good benchmark of what a typical customer pays.
We kind of melded together several different time periods. We looked at the billing data from 2009, from which we applied the rates that went into effect January 10 of this year. So it's we recalculated the rate revenue coming in, assuming that the current rates had been in place for the entire period that we reviewed, which was the 12 months ending June 2009. We also went ahead and used the pro forma, the budgeted numbers for fiscal year 11 for our rate design purposes. We want to look forward when we design rates. So that's we have billing data from 2009, fiscal year 2009, under current rates, which came into effect January 2010, and we're looking forward into this fiscal year's expenses. Why do we go in? Why do we do it? You know, what are the objectives of a study? You want to make sure that you have stable revenue and it's efficient to run your systems. Ultimately, at the end of the day, and whether it's a 3-year or 5-year window, you want sewer customers to pay for sewer and water to pay for water. You don't want to have water subsidizing sewer or vice versa. The buzzwords are fairness and equity. You want to make sure that they're fair rates and they're equitable rates. And that's, again, that goes back to separating your water from sewer. And also not having too much subsidies between classes, whether it's commercial inside subsidizing residential inside or residential outside subsidizing inside.
Well, now wait, let me ask you a question. As far as I know, the city of Franklin has always charged a premium for its water and wastewater outside the city. And I actually have no objection to that.
Right.
Whenever you're talking about subsidizing, to me, that is not a subsidy. It is a premium that those people pay because they're not in
right, they're receiving city services while paying taxes. And that's an outside of a cost of service. That's I have my little spreadsheet world with cost of service numbers. Then we have the real world, social, political side, bond covenants. We just need to. That's I don't consider that a subsidization. That's paying their fair share. It's just a different definition.
And I might interject. My goals here would be we want to know what those cost of services are. I mean, so we know exactly what it costs of service. And then we do need to discuss, as an example, if you're out of zone, or that's not a good word to use with the rezoning that's been going on, but if you're out of the city, what percentage increase should it be? I mean, right now they're really kind of arbitrary. I mean, this one's that one or that one's that one. And I think that we should be pretty consistent. So if somebody came to us and said, "I need to have I'm out of the urban growth boundaries. I want to have sewer. What would it cost me?" And we could say, "Well, it's your cost of service plus 30% or whatever it is." And then that number could actually just be a number that just stays consistent. That we would know what it is. And so what we're trying to find out today is like that baseline. What is that cost of service? Not to
As I recall, it was a just definite percentage.
Yeah, but there's no we don't have any standard. It has fluctuated. We've changed it off and on, and
we changed it last time because we lessened the right. premium. But up until then, for many years, I assume, and I don't know what the surcharge was, but it was
70. Was it 70%?
I'm not 70%.
Huh?
It was
170%.
Yeah.
So
it was
70%
more.
Yeah. So
we've
come way down from that.
We've gone away from that, yes.
That's
significantly.
Right.
And, you know, even, you know, one of the things that we talk about when we annex people, that there's an advantage to being within the city because you get a lower water and sewer rate. And I think that's, if we get away from that, then it'll make it even harder to get people to buy into annexation. Okay. It's hard enough as it is, but we try to show some economic reason, mm-hmm. and I think there should be
one
because we are using our bond rating. We are using other things that people outside the city don't yeah. get. So anyway, that are we up? We're up. We're ready.
Yes, yes.
We've killed enough time.
We're alive.
You've got 30 seconds.
All right. Again, just a brief overview. I know this is the second or third year we've been here, but I sat down with Mark and management and determined that the revenue requirements, how much does the system need to make? The second step then is to develop the requirements by class. Once you go in and classify and then allocate the expenses relative to the four rate classes. And at that point, we look to design rates. And that's where this year we're coming in. We have an either looking at a three-year window or a five-year window with the idea of getting to where water is paying for water and sewer is fully paying for sewer. We'll look at the water cost of service study first, and it'll be eight to ten slides. Then we'll look at wastewater, and then kind of the 3 and 5 year. Let's look forward. How do we go about getting the money we need to get? This is your water revenue requirement. Again, we use the cash basis methodology. When we get to debt service, that includes principal and interest, and then your rate funded capital number of 1.1. That's how much money that we need to bring in from rates to properly maintain the system. Right now, that we're staying consistent with what we've done in the past at 1.1 million. So we have O&M of 7.5. Your small taxes, which is only about $80,000, so that your total revenue requirement for the water system projected for 2011, this is this fiscal year, is 9.1 million. From that, we back out your other revenues, your late charges, any type of miscellaneous fees that offset the revenue needed to come in from rates, so that our rate requirement for the water system is projected to be about 8.6 million for this year. And again, of that number, 83% is O&M expense, minimal expense or minimal taxes. Rate funded capital is only 12%. Revenue requirement by class on slide number 7. You can see that just over 9 figure, your residential inside of 6 million is obviously your main rate class. And I show this that, you know, we could sit here and hem and haw about commercial inside or commercial industrial outside, and if we triple their rates, it's not going to have really a material impact on the system. But the, you know, if you stack the four rate classes on top of one another, you have the full revenue requirement for the system.
And I want to say, because I was questioning this, commercial also includes homeowners associations, their water bills, and mainly water. There's probably not a lot of sewer bill on homeowners associations, but mm-hmm. filling a swimming pool and doing irrigation mm-hmm. and those kind of things. Now, there is other commercial, but that is inclusive in that category, just so you know.
The next slide is the requirement per 1,000 gallons by the system and by rate class. You can see for the system, it's just under $6. Residential inside and out are just over $6. And your commercials are a little bit less than, or right at $5, basically. And that's due to higher volumes or absorbing some of the fixed charges. So you have the lower requirement per 1,000 gallons or per unit. Revenue requirement by class. 70% coming from resident or should come from residential inside, 13 residential out, 16 commercial in, and 1 commercial out. It's currently coming in 61% from residential inside. So if we look back, ideally in the cost of service, should 70% of the revenue should be coming from the residential inside class. Currently, only 61% is coming from the residential inside class.
Again, that is based on that pure cost of service
right.
model. So
that's not taking into account the premiums we pay for outside the city customers. That's pure, just raw data provided. The key slide and the ultimate takeaway slide for both water and sewer, we'll get to sewer in a moment, but for the water system, you're at 90% recovery. That means for every $100 we should be bringing in, we're only bringing in 90. The big driver there, your residential inside class is currently recovering at 78 cents on the dollar. This is not unusual at all. You see you have your residential out, and commercial, both commercial classes are above 100%. In a perfect cost of service world, both the system and all four rate classes would be recovering right at 100%.
But doesn't that mean that all these big users, which I'm taking to be the commercial, would be really paying as much for their high-end use as they are for kind of a medium-end use? And aren't we trying to encourage conservation and
yes,
cutbacks correct. On that? So in reality, whenever you're talking about 100% there, yep. you're not taking into consideration that we are attempting to encourage savings where
right.
they can be done.
Exactly.
And so that
and again, that's bringing
this.
In a conservation, a social measure to a black and white study.
Exactly.
And then, again, this is not an unusual picture at all due to measures like a conservation or an inclining block, right?
And our goal is to have the left-hand column be 100%.
Yes.
That's our goal. And so some combination of the next four columns need to equal 100%, mm-hmm. and we have to figure out how we get there. And there's a direct relationship between the amount of users and the percentage, and so that's one of our issues. Like commercial out is just such a minor mm-hmm. percentage of it that it, as they were saying, this could be 300%, and might not even budge the total number. So we have to look at that. And again, this one, and then the same way with sewer, are really your most critical graphs, and that's what we have to play with and tinker with. Margaret?
Are we looking at any reclaimed water in this?
No.
This at this point, this is purely water.
Water.
Just
they're
separate,
drinking water.
They're separate funds. Yep.
This drinking is water, water and then wastewater.
And wastewater.
So nowhere in this is that?
Reclaimed water.
Okay.
No.
Yep.
Right.
And results and recommendations for the water system, again, based off of 2009 usage, 2010 rates, 2011 projected expenses, we're under recovering by about $950,000. That's that 10% gap between 90 and 100%. I mentioned it here, we've addressed the social issues or the conservation issues in that we have that inclining block rate now. And that's in place, and that is a very good measure for several reasons. I would recommend when the time comes, we need to look at that fixed charge, the customer charge or the access charge. That appears, based off of our study, that appears to be where the gap lies. That inclining block rate is helping in that it's not prohibitive enough really to completely curb usage, and you're getting a little bit additional revenue because you do have those higher charges in place once you get to those outer blocks of the rate structure.
And the reality is the fiscal year we just completed, we really did match revenue and expenses pretty much right on. So what this does is takes what's in that projected budget and applies the existing rate structure to it to show what that gap could be. And part of why we made that work in the last fiscal year is we underspent. We didn't spend as much, didn't have to buy as much water from outside. There were other costs that we were able to control. But from a budgetary standpoint, we've got to look at the full potential exposure in terms of operating the utility, and that's what this takes into account.
In many previous years, I have never assumed that we had real problems in the revenue that came through the water fund here. So is it now because we are including in here maintenance, regular maintenance, regularly timed maintenance, I put it that way? Because as I say, have we ever had a problem
from the study's perspective, you're not operating in the red by any stretch.
That's right.
You have that rate-funded capital number of $1.1 million, I believe. We're just not fully funding that rate-funded capital measure at this point.
So is that rate-funded capital, is that maintenance and repairs and
new stuff.
Because normally new comes from the water impact.
It's largely maintaining the existing
right.
system.
That's what I wanted to hear.
Existing maintenance needs of the system.
You can, to some extent, it can be considered a replacement for depreciation expense.
Yes, okay.
Depreciation expense is not included in the top line O&M for operations and maintenance expense.
You mean like the reservoir?
Yeah. Our replacement of a pump, that's what I was talking about, new stuff. New pumps, the stuff that are already not expanded service, but maintaining and keeping the product that we have now in the level that, and that's going to fluctuate. You know, some years we may not spend, and I think that was your point, this year we haven't spent what we might normally spend, and that's not a straight line. That's going to be a line like that, but we need to plan for it in a straight line.
So but does that mean we'd be putting 1.1 million in every year for this, whether we spend it or not?
Mm-hmm.
Is that what this is saying? I think it is, isn't
right,
it? It's saying we're going to put in the one. We're going to charge in the 1.1.
At this point, this is the expenses are a snapshot of fiscal year 2011. When we look at the 3 and 5 year approaches, those are based off of management's budget, which and is based off, I believe, for the rate funded capital. It's we have 1.1 million this year as our baseline, and then we're increasing that by 5%.
Could I ask what those costs have been for the last 10 years for each year? That would be something of interest to me.
Of the rate funded capital number?
Yep.
You don't have to give it right now.
No, I'm not talking off the top of your head.
Yeah.
No, but I would really like to see that.
Yeah.
I think that would be helpful.
We'll get with finance.
And one of the goals that we, if we look at, if we go out 5 years, even though we might go out 5 years and set a rate structure for 5 years, our expectation is that we will look at it every year. So that you know, we project it, we say this is what it's going to be, but every year we analyze so that if we're, you know, if over a couple of years we've got a larger reserve fund than we think we need to do, we can cut that back a little bit, but it needs to be looked at every year so that we can stay on track and we can get where we need to be. And again, that rate funded capital, is that what the word is? That you know, everything else is normally funded either through, like you say, impact fees or debt structure.
Like that.
And
right.
These would be things that would not be. These would be things that we would pay basically the pay as you go type of stuff.
Correct.
If there's enough reserve funding. Okay.
Question.
Yeah.
The big lines that are going down Downs Boulevard to help provide water kind of to the southeast. How do you calculate, is that included in cost for inside the city, even though part of that water is going to help? You see what I'm saying?
That eventually is going to get paid out through a debt service, and I don't remember the specific fund.
No, what I'm saying is when you're calculating expenses for inside the city versus outside.
We're not doing that. We're just doing expenses in general.
Okay.
That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to do cost of services regardless of where it lays. And then we figure out what kind of percentages we put onto it. So really the cost to delivering, whether it's inside or outside, is the same. It doesn't really cost you anymore. Just pure, I mean, the lines might be a little bit longer, but not necessarily. I mean,
that's right. I mean, some outside might be closer than some inside.
Well,
right?
Yeah. Well, look at the out Lewisburg Pike. I mean, you know, we provide service to places beyond it, and those subdivisions right there, past Sullivan Farms. You know, so what we're trying to come up to is just really, and not get it down to the 1/100th of a penny, but you know, in general, what is the basic cost of a gallon of water, and then incremental costs from there, and that's pretty much the same inside or outside, and same way with sewer as well.
Right.
That pretty good description. Okay.
I'm in.
All right.
If there are no more questions on water, I'll move to wastewater, and it's going to be the exact same slides we've looked at, obviously with sewer's numbers in, but same slides from a formatting perspective. O&M expense for sewer, $7.6 million. Debt service of $1.9 million. And then your rate funded capital number of $3 million for sewer gives your total revenue requirement of about $12.6 million, backing out the other revenues so that your rate revenue requirement is right at $12.5 million.
Let me just ask you a quick question. How many water customers do we have, and how many sewer customers do we have?
About 18,000 water, and I think it's 20, 22-23 sewer.
Okay.
You would have thought there would have been a little bit of a gap in that.
18,000 water?
Yes, sir.
And 20,000 sewer?
22.
Because a lot of our...
are from...
our sewer in...
I thought that would be a bigger number.
Yeah. They're in another water district.
Let's get that number.
We'll get the number.
Yeah. I've got it as of, it'd be a year and a half old. But yeah.
That's fine. Okay. That just came to my head, and if I don't say it now, I'll completely forget it, so...
And this is just a graphical representation of the numbers we looked at. Your O&M expense for sewer is about 60% of the total revenue requirement or rate revenue requirement. Rate funded capital here is roughly double percentage from water. Water was 12% here. With sewer, it's 24%. Your debt service is up a little bit to 15% as well. Again, revenue requirement by class, you see the $12.5 million there on the left-hand column. That's the total requirement for the system. Residential inside, again, is the major player here, and then your commercial inside will be second. Your revenue requirement by 1,000 gallons. Total for the system is just under $6, with the two commercials well under that. Your residential outside is a good bit higher to that, and that's main driver there. Why that seems to be an outlier is there the average consumption per customer residential outside is a good bit lower than comparative to residential inside. So yeah, the fixed expenses, we have fewer units from which we take those out or divide those out. Revenue requirement by class, residential inside is 75%, your commercial inside is 23. That's the goal. That's ideally, again, if each class was pulling its own cost of service weight, it'd be 75% for residential inside. Right now, it's at 71%. But ultimately, if I pull those percentages away, those charts look pretty much the same. You have your current compared to what it should be. Not a material difference there. Your current recoveries by class and for the system, 76% for the system, of which the vast majority being residential inside is currently recovering at 72 cents. And again, in a perfect cost of service world, everybody is right at 100%. For the 12 months ending June 2011, the city is projected under recover by about $3 million, which again, that's pretty much right at that rate funded capital number. Additional increases are warranted, and given that it's recovering in the mid 70% range, a long-term approach to full recovery is recommended, meaning you didn't, I'll say this hole wasn't dug in a year. You don't need to try and get out of it in 1 year either. Take a multi-year approach, and that's why I was asked to look at take a three-year look and a five-year look as far as how do we want to tackle this, how do we want to move forward in our rate design, and how much revenue do we want to bring in each step along the way.
What we talked about before was just do a linear chart, knowing that we can't cover it all at one time, and figure out how much would it take to get to break even at 3 years, and how much would it take to do it at 5 years. And so the next couple of charts will show that. But we didn't want to do it all at once. We're not going to do it all at once. So let's try to be realistic about how we can do this. And certainly five looks better than three.
I would like to point out before Jim goes into the percentages here, this is a revenue increase versus a across the board rate increase. So because the rates are not all equal, it's applied. You have to look at it in terms of revenue versus what the rate increase would be. So I just wanted to point out.
There are options within how you structure rates with the availability charge is sort of a fixed cost, and then a per unit cost, if you will, a variable cost on rates along with that. So there are a lot of different ways to structure it.
Yes.
How did we get in this hole, $3 million hole?
Well, again, because we don't charge enough.
Have we been in the red ever before?
Yes.
Have we?
My observation is that typically what happens is you set the rate. There's an institutional reluctance to raise them mm-hmm. every year. Costs never go down. Service requirements go up. And you come back and realize that, not surprisingly, costs going up and rates being flat, you're operating at a deficit, and then you raise them again. You raise them to the level that'll get you out of that hole, and then the institutional reluctance to rate increases sets in again. And it's cyclical. That doesn't mean it's nefarious or even that it's neglectful. It's just sort of the way these things get done.
The utility managers, more often than not, if they can, will kind of stick their chest out and say, we hadn't had a rate increase in 15 years. Well, name me one expense that hadn't gone up in that time frame. And in that, there's rate shock to kind of fill that hole if you hadn't had a rate increase in 15 years. That's a substantial rate increase. I mean, that's not a 5 or 6%. That's a 30 or 40% increase for two or three consecutive years to get whole again. And that's why we want to take a measured approach, whether it be 3 years or 5 years, to incrementally eat into that gap. And again, you're not operating in the red. We're just not, at this point, not fully funding that rate-funded capital number.
And I think everybody needs to, there's a big difference between revenue for water and sewer and revenue for the city, mm-hmm. as an example, because the water and sewer doesn't get the benefit of sales tax revenue going up as population increases and as property values increase. And so while we can say in the city we haven't raised taxes in 20 some odd years, we can't say that our revenue hasn't gone up, because it has gone up significantly. It's gone up because of those two items have increased in value. Water and sewer doesn't have that same opportunity. So we can't sit back and say we're not raising rates, because we're going to have to, because we don't have a corresponding increase in revenue like we have in those other revenue classes. And I think that makes a difference.
But we have not spent any of the money that was paid to us for capital improvements in those funds. We have not spent them for just ongoing revenue, have we?
Say that again, I'm sorry.
You know, we get money for our impact fees, mm-hmm. And access fees for both water and sewer. Mm-hmm. We have not been using that money for our ongoing expenses, have we?
Daily operations.
That's right. Thank you.
For daily operations, I think, and Russ would better answer that question, but I think what it is that we talk about revenue mix and where our money funds come from. I think we actually do pull money over from those funds to support operations.
Well, your capital gets blended.
Correct.
And how you divide, what we're looking at is how we divide up the capital needs of the system,
okay.
between what is operationally ongoing based and what is growth driven.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're trying to get in sync here, is what's truly the prospective needs of the system, and what do we need to fund from a capital standpoint from existing ratepayers and that sort of thing, customers paying that way, and then what are the system growth needs, and those are paid by access fees and
But we have continued to do that. Those things that were paid into mm-hmm. as access fees and impact fees for water and sewer have not been used just for the ongoing.
No, and that's part of how you fund your capital program, and that's part of the existing debt structure that we have. But we're looking going forward, what are the needs that we need to draw from our customer base to pay for ongoing capital operation needs?
In other words, for our operation of the existing system.
Yes.
The water system is largely built out.
You're right. We
do not have a lot of undeveloped service area left.
Yeah.
And the
I know we're not.
So capital is likely to be replacement.
Yes.
Correct.
There's more replacement as we
is the only money that we'll be receiving to in order to maintain.
Well, as we annex the UGB, that will increase that.
Our service area is divorced from the UGB. We have service area that is outside of the UGB and will remain that. I mean, under any circumstance, we have area that is in the city, in the service area, we have service area that will never be annexed because it is politically impossible that the UGB would be expanded to cover our service area. Quite the opposite, actually. We have retreated from service areas that were ours to serve for one reason or another, sometimes just politically. We have declined to serve an area and said, fine. Because when we do that, the neighboring utility is given the authority and permission to go in and do it. So everybody's entitled to have a utility service them if the utility is willing. But you can't block another service provider from providing if you're able but unwilling. So it's annexation will likely never change our service area or the fact that our service area is largely built out.
So in these charts, we've got
to get to the 3 and 5 year.
That's I'm on slide 25. This slide and the next three we'll look at are all formatted the same way for both water and sewer. You have your actual rate requirement on the top left, followed by your budgeted numbers for 11, 12, and 13 in the three-year approach. Obviously, five-year will continue out to 2015. That's represented in the blue chart. That's the blue number there. I also mentioned that when I prepared this, 2010 numbers were not available. That's why you see the gap between 2009 and budgeted year 11. And then we have the current year, if you percentage change here, 13.1%, that's the increase. 2009 to 2011, that's 13.1%. Dollar amounts, just doing the math, is right at $1 million. Our rate revenue currently would be $7.7 million based off of today's rates. If we propose a 6% rate increase, that'd be additional, that'd bring in revenue of about $460,000. You'd still have that shortfall of just under $500,000. Follow that up with a 5% rate increase the next year, or essentially a straight line of 6, 5, and 5. You can see as the red line gradually meets that blue line, that shows that our revenue is matching the revenue requirement. So that's where we need to be. And that's a 6% increase, 5 and 5, and that the revenue minus requirement, the top right numbers there, you see how we eat into that, the difference. That's just taking the current revenue or the proposed revenue minus the projected expenses. Now we have the same exact slide, but on a 5 year. Spreading out to 5 years allows you, instead of having a 6, 5, and 5, just 4% increases for the 5 years. Obviously, goes without saying, that's a steady approach. 4% increase would bring in $308,000 this year, $320,000, $321,000 next year. Keeping in mind, this is based off of 2009 consumption data. If we have an exceptionally wet year, when we go to look at this again, right now, the way the rates are set up, that you're fairly weather sensitive in that fixed component isn't quite where it needs to be. So we'll say margins are tied to your usage or your consumption. If that drops off, then there's going to be a greater shortfall. But just from a general revenue, needed revenue perspective, 4% a year for the next 5 years should get you, based off of the current budget, would get you right, essentially break even a positive $19,000.
Let me ask you, were saying that if the usage goes down, but doesn't that mean that we're not having to pay as much to Harpeth Valley if the usage goes down?
It depends on that. To some extent, yes, but yeah, there are expenses that are fixed that don't vary based off of usage.
Well, you mentioned usage is the reason that I brought it up.
So that's if your customer charge was where it needed to be relative to the cost of service study, then you're bringing in everything you need to bring in. Because it might cost, and I can't remember off the top of my head, $20 to be a customer on the system before you buy the first gallon of water every month. Right now you're at $8 or $9, so there's a gap there. And you gradually make that up based off of that inclining block rate. But if it's a wet year, the irrigators aren't going to be using 18,000 gallons at their home. It's going to be closer to 10 or 12. So that's, you have that shortfall there.
And your biggest fixed cost, again, is your rate-funded capital. So, I mean, it's 12 or 13%, so that number doesn't change. So as your volume decreases, that rate funded capital becomes a higher percentage of your volume.
Right.
And so I think that's probably your biggest, that's why.
Again, I'd like to see that those amounts for the last 10 years on that.
Moving on to slide 29 is wastewater. It's the same three-year approach, same formatting. Again, we have actual information for 2009 with budgeted for 11, 12, and 13. Given that substantial shortfall of right around $3 million, to do it in a three-year time frame would be a 10% increase each year. You'd basically have to knock off $1 million a year to get to even relative to the budgeted information or budgeted amounts for 2013. Moving on to the five-year, we're looking at 7% increases for the first 4 years and then down to 6% for the fifth and final year of this approach. We'd look at bringing in, you know, this year it'd be $660,000 roughly as opposed to $1 million on the three-year approach. And you can see it's just a measured steps getting that red line or red bar caught up to the blue. And this is the actual budgeted amounts for operating budget through 2015.
So for the person that's watching, what does that mean on their water bill and their sewer bill? If we go with the five-year path, the average 7,000 gallon user, what's that going to mean?
It really depends on, again, these are
Mark, let me we're going to come back with that number. That's what we're going to do. So don't even say anything. We're going to come back with that number. The point, what we were trying to get accomplished today.
Yeah.
Well, what we're trying to get accomplished today is do you like the direction that we're headed, the methodology, and are we more comfortable with 5 years rather than three? I think that's a consensus.
Yes. Yeah.
And we would have the ability, Jim will bring back his computer, and he's got a model so that we can do some what-if calculations at a work session. So, but we wanted to again, as Clyde said, get the methodology moving. And if we can do that, then that gives him the freedom to then do some rate calculations and understand where we're going to go from there.
Okay, and right now, the wastewater fee is based on our water, on an individual's water usage, and it is what percent of that?
Really depends on which class you're in. It's not a set percentage.
Oh, that's the residential. I forget the rest of it. For residential.
But for residential, I don't know what the exact percentage differential is. It's an individual calculation. It's not based on a percentage of water consumption.
Oh, I thought
It's a per gallon.
It's a per gallon.
Yeah, but it's. I can tell you what those individual rates are.
Well, just that would be for our next thing.
For our next work.
But I thought it was all based on your water usage.
It's not a set percentage. It's not a. It's always 130% of water or X percent of water. It depends on.
You're talking about sewer.
I'm talking about sewer because that's. I thought that's the way you charged it.
You're not exactly the same rate structure because water has an availability charge plus a per gallon charge. Sewer's just per gallon.
Water also has an inclining block, and sewer has a declining block as well. So there's not a precise percentage.
They're both based off of usage, but the rate structures are a little different.
Well, I thought the reason that people's water and wastewater bills were so expensive when they irrigated is because their wastewater was charged on how much water they're using.
It's because it's a per gallon charge.
Yeah.
It is per gallon, but as wastewater, as you increase your water consumption, the wastewater cost per 1,000 gallons declines. So the higher volume you consume in water, the wastewater rate goes down.
Well, let's just
an attempt to accommodate.
No.
Let's just cut it to this. Will my 7,000 gallon wastewater bill be any different from Ann's 7,000 gallon?
No.
Good enough.
No.
But if we were using more water, then you're saying it would be different.
The percentage of your sewer would be less
compared to each other.
To compare to each other.
Yes.
That's right. So
It'd be interesting to see, you know, as our other.
We set a table up that goes per 1,000 gallons, tell you what the water and sewer bill would be.
Right.
And what you've got here, I think is real interesting, that was passed out as your rate comparison sheets. I think that's real interesting to look at, and just know that the first four, not counting Brentwood, but MUD is Mill Crofton Utility District, MVUD is Maui Valley, HB&TS is HB&TS. Those are the three water providers that provide water for citizens of Franklin. The other ones don't, but I think that's those are this is real interesting information for all of us to look at as we go forward in a rate structure.
The takeaway here would be that looking at your 7,000 gallon water residential customer, that the bill would be $29.54 currently for the city of Franklin, whereas you know you see one HB&TS is over $50. They're at $51. They're substantially higher than the city of Franklin. Mill Crofton is also a good bit higher. The only one lower is Harpeth Valley, and given their size, that certainly is reasonable to expect. The average,
and they produce the all the water.
These others don't have the
I would expect that to be.
They're all buying it from them.
Okay.
And the same scenario plays out on the sewer side. Right now, City of Franklin is lower than the other two sewer comparisons that we have available.
I would again say, you know, think about this. If you've got pertinent questions, get them to Mark, and then we're going to schedule a water rate meeting just to discuss that as well. So if you got, you know.
Okay. Do I have to say mine where I asked for the last 10 years?
No, we've got that.
Okay.
And we'll work off of a five-year
I think approach. Five-year approach is fine. Thank you, Jim. Appreciate it. Thank you, Mark. Okay, item number 11, review and discussion regarding Eastern Flank Battlefield Access Road. There's not going to be much discussion. So you don't even need to sit much unless you're on the next item. You're not.
So.
You don't need to stay. What we decided, what was told us by our legal counsel is that we cannot do the design build concept.
Gotcha.
And so we're going to regroup and we're going to think about some other alternatives and some options and come back to you quickly with some just kind of where we think we need to go. I think right now I'm not ready to go hire Lil John to do an engineering study to design that road for 70 something thousand bucks. So.
And how much were they paid before? Because it said revisions to.
Yeah, and I, that we're going to get some of that information. Okay.
May I probably share that Andrew Orr has said that there may be some grant possibilities for us to apply for some grant opportunities.
How long would that take?
We're gonna
I want to see what you're gonna do with this one.
Well, Eric and I've had several discussions on this particular.
We're gonna have bouncers.
Yeah. Come on.
Yeah. We're going to wallpaper. It's decor instead of decor. I'm not sure I want to have a lot of discussion on this tonight. In fact, I may not want to have any.
Ever.
But what I want you to do is look at it and think about it. It was staff's recommendation. Actually, I will tell you, you got here without me knowing that it was on there. But that's okay. There are some things in there that I don't agree with. There's some things in there that I do agree with. As an example, when we were talking and doing the school thing, I was pretty adamant about not allowing signs to be flashed during the board meetings. And I don't think there's a place for that here. I think it's intimidating and it's disruptive. And so there may be some things as you think about that might be where we can say to people, no, you can't do that here. and I don't know if that's the right one or not. There are things on there I could care less about. And there's also a huge differential between what may happen at a work session or at a board meeting or at a planning commission meeting or at a committee level meeting. And I guess what we might say is, do you have any interest in pursuing this, or are we okay where we are, and is everybody happy with what we got right now? Yes, sir.
I think, having been here for 13 years, I can think of only maybe a few instances where the proposed decorum policy would have even been applicable. I think that it is our job to sit here and listen to people complain if they want to come in here and complain. Someone who takes the time as a citizen to step out of their... We come here because we ask for this job. Okay? I say we, I mean the elected officials. The rest of you signed up. The rest of you that are here because you're getting paid to be here signed up for it too. But when a citizen comes in off the street, they have made a decision that it is important enough to them to interrupt whatever else they were doing to come down here and share whatever it is that's on their mind with us. In my view, it is our responsibility to listen. Now, if they want to show up with hats and banners and whatever else, that has only rarely happened, and it has really never been a big problem. And I think that we risk creating exactly the kind of negative reaction that we would like to avoid when we attempt in advance to censor the opportunity for people to share their opinion with us. So telling someone that they can't boo, that's like telling someone they can't heckle the umpire. I mean, and I saw a baseball game the other night that made the news because the umpire completely lost his mind. He first threw out a base coach or a bench coach. He then threw out a player from the other team, and he then threw out a fan. Okay?
Right through them all.
And so making a list of rules like this, to me, given how little we've really had a problem with some of these things, and then specifying what people can't do, and I think we are attempting to apply a solution where there hasn't been much of a problem. I think you create the possibility of unintended consequences, and I would be reluctant to try to proscribe in advance what people can do when they want to redress their government, because the people that come down here are motivated to have done that. Now, they may be off base, and they may be misinformed, and they may be unhappy, but they are motivated. And I would tread very lightly on a list of thou shalt nots, about, because this is, most of the people that we hear from are never going to go down and attempt to talk to their congressman or go to the floor of the Senate and say something. They're going to come here because we're building a road, or we're not building a road, or we're dealing with a school issue that we didn't ask for, that kind of thing. I have some concern about telling people what they can't do, and I am particularly concerned about telling people that they have 2 minutes. I don't want to be here till midnight listening to the same thing again and again, any more than anyone else. But it struck me as unfortunate that the school board proposed to rezone every school in the county and then allocated all of 30 minutes combined for anyone and everyone who was motivated to address them to fit in their comments. They too get paid to listen. And at this point, with 13 years of looking back on what I wish could have been different about the things that have happened in this room, nearly none of them have anything to do with the people that came here and went to the podium.
Let me ask, is everybody sort of in agreement with that?
Well, I'm not in disagreement with that, but I'm not.
But a two-minute limit, some of the specifics of what was just said, I don't have a particular problem with.
My response to that, I told that to Eric, is that a lot of these rules are covered under Robert's Rules of Orders that give the chairman the authority.
The charter gives you the authority to fine people and throw them out, too.
And so, and as an example, what we did when we allowed the residents to talk on the zoning, I said we'd like to keep it to 2 minutes. Mm-hmm. You know, the dong came off, but I never really cut anybody off, mm-hmm. you know. No. And so I think that I really don't have I'm really not a big fan of this either. So I'm comfortable in leaving it where it is.
And there, as far as I'm concerned, there is a difference between the workshop.
I agree.
And a board meeting. This is more of a committee meeting, workshop, where there should be greater flexibility, right. And somebody should be able to come up and have their say, whereas the board meeting is a more structured meeting.
But again, Robert's Rules of Order provides
that's fine.
I can dictate what can be done.
Right, and if it's a public hearing, though, everybody who wishes to speak certainly has.
And I don't like necessarily saying you have to sign it before you come, because if you're sitting there in the audience and something hits you, you'll come up and say something.
The only thing is, we do need the name, because many times I have seen, especially recently, that you know we just don't get the name for our minutes, and that was, and it's not our fault.
But we can do a better job.
I think we should. I totally agree with that. And when people come, I think they ought to be required to spell their names and say where they're from and their address like they usually
do. Well, we can worry about that.
We can do it.
Things, but really, you can handle it.
I totally agree that they shouldn't have to sign up in the card. But, you know, the other thing is we've got people that...
Does Bev have to...
And Beverly, how do you spell your name, Beverly? Did you?
B-U. but when those people come in, I sort of agree with the sign thing. You know, that gets disruptive. But I totally agree with Dana on this. I mean, when people come in, if we have, and we've always told people, if you're going to say the same thing, save yourself the time. Just it's ask for four or five people to speak for you. And it's always nice to have, I'm here representing, I'm speaking for these people. Would you all stand up or mm-hmm, show your hands? Mm-hmm. I like that, because I like to see who showed up.
Sure.
And I think that's helpful, and usually you're really good at asking for that.
I just wanted to give sort of the perspective as why we brought this forward. And it really was not that we particularly have a problem, but the best time to get in front of that is before you are faced with it. And this is really, I would look at this more of a menu of things that you could look at and consider it as part of your policy. And something that we could have that's very understandable to people about what the expectations are in a public meeting. And for precisely some of the reasons that you all have talked about, so that folks don't get shouted down or intimidated from having an opportunity to speak their mind, because there are certain standards of how people get an opportunity to express themselves, but do it in a way that is still conducive to an open public process, which is where we all want to be. But there are just, I think, might be some guidelines you want to look at so that that we could put out there and even post for folks so that they know when they come in what is okay and what's not okay. And it can be as much as you're comfortable with it being. It doesn't need to be as exhaustive as this, but there might be some benefit to spelling out some of those basic expectations up front, because your average citizen doesn't really know how Robert's Rules of Order apply to a meeting like this. They just want to speak their mind, and that's good. But we want to provide some guidelines about what protects their ability to do it, and what framework they get to do that in. And it's entirely up to you. This is your meeting and the public's meetings, but these are some ideas we wanted to get out for you to think about that might be helpful, because some of us have seen meetings go very badly in other places, and guidelines like these might have helped. That's just...
Well, one of the things I think that is important, which you just brought up, but I think it's real important to make the people feel comfortable. Mm-hmm. And if you had just 5 or 10 bullet points of saying, if you have something to hand out during your talk, go straight to the mayor and give it to it or somebody else, not to have to worry about handing it out. You know, what is allowed and disallowed that are just major things, or, you know, not any of these, that's not major in the minors, what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. I think people feel more comfortable, because I had people come in here before for some of these issues, and they ask, they said, now where do we sign up? Do we have to give a card and blah, blah, and they want to know. And I think it would be helpful to give them that ability to be more relaxed, so they know. And if it's just a few bullet points listed on the podium there, or on the column or something, I think that's helpful. Let's be helpful to the people and not be a hindrance.
And that's kind of what we were thinking. Sometimes it seems like people do prepare to come to a meeting, and they're interested in what they're going to say to you, and they prepare their documents or prepare their signs, and then they get here, they don't know what happens, and then rules are made from the podium, and it's not always the same rules based on who's talking and what the issue is. And that's where we're concerned. We just need a level playing field.
But I will tell you, I like that, because I think the situation dictates the rules.
Well, but sometimes that could be a problem when you're talking about
sure
speech.
Sure can, but anything can be a problem.
But let me tell you, that's true. You know, people, I would say, in this community know how to behave.
Yeah.
They may come whenever they are very concerned, and I do appreciate the fact that they have taken their time to come down. But I mean, I do not feel that the people in this community need to be educated on how to act. And that, unfortunately...
And that's not what we're trying to say.
But let me tell you, you look at this.
We're trying to provide
this is what that says. And even if you're talking about putting bullet points out there, to me, that is pretty condescending, in my opinion.
That was not our intent.
Well, it looked like it. I'm just saying, that's the way it came across.
And let me say, when the people came in here to speak on the zoning issues of the school and the land, so many of them asked me, they said, am I allowed to do this? Am I allowed to do that? And basically, and then so many of them asked me, where do we sign up? Where's the cards to sign up? Because they've been in other communities where they had to sign up. That gives them a level of comfort to be a little bit more in control. And those major things, I think, are helpful to the people, not the other stuff.
Okay, we've got to move this.
One more comment, and mine will be short. Bridgeway happened to be one of the best citizen comment meetings.
And it went very well.
Public meetings that I have been in where there was something extremely controversial. Right. So you can't use Bridgeway.
No,
they were good.
Well,
and I think the person presiding has to have some leeway.
Yeah, I agree with that. All right, let's go to item number 13. Consideration, and we'd like to make sure we kind of get through this, because item 17 we really have maybe some discussion with, and then we have some people here to discuss that who we need to get after.
Do we need to say anything about this?
I don't care about that. Yeah, Vernon, you don't know. You're not Vernon. Okay.
Tom's playing
Vernon. Is anybody got a comment on 13?
No.
No comment on 13. Thanks, Tom.
No. Thank you.
Excellent. 14, consideration of bid to National Data Surveying Services of Beverly Hills, California, an amount of $14,650 for purchase of vehicular traffic data collection contract services for the Traffic Operations Center.
Seems good.
All right.
Needed help.
Item number 15, acknowledgement of the amendment to number 2 to the agreement between the Franklin Transit Authority and Team A Group. This was just a required thing. We're good. All right. Item number 16, the fire department gets to wear pink. When do you do that?
During the month of October, for 30 days before the end of the month.
So if you see the firemen not wearing pink, you'll know what that's all about.
25th, 26th, 27th.
25th.
Who pays for the pink?
Do you want us to wear pink too?
Who pays for the pink uniforms?
It is not the financial impact. Our firefighters association is agreeing to buy all.
Oh, how good! How good!
Okay, item number 17. How was that? That was quick.
That's good.
Y'all want to come up?
Last on the list. So patient.
Sorry to make you sit through all that, but sometimes you...
That's the way it is.
It is quite educating.
No,
it may not be anything. Do you have a hat?
So we need
you didn't bring your hat,
this
did
is
you?
How you act.
Sign the card. Keep the comments for 2 minutes. Then we're going to let you go. Live that down, right?
Who wants to start? You want to start with this? Or Shauna, do you want to start? Or do you... I don't care.
This has just come up recently in terms of TW Telecom of Tennessee and their interest in basically putting facilities in the right-of-way, and they have approached us about it. We gave them sort of a standard franchise back that really probably more applies to video providers as well, and they provided this back to us, and we're making you aware of this. We wanted them to have an opportunity to describe what the service is that they're proposing to provide to the community, how this fits in, and ultimately we're recommending to have the opportunity to work further with them and negotiating some sort of agreement between the parties. So
please introduce yourself, spell your name, and you got now a minute and 22 seconds.
My name's Chuck Welch. I'm with the Ferris Matthews Law Firm in Nashville and represent TW Telecom, formerly Time Warner Telecom. This is Carolyn Ridley, who is the Vice President of Regulatory Affairs for the Southeast Region. And we have been working together on telecom issues for about the last 16 years. I'll let Carolyn tell you a little bit about what the company does, and we want to do business in Franklin. It's a good place, and we've got folks that want to use our services, and we want to provide them. And I'll let Carolyn tell you what sort of services we provide and how we provide them.
Thank you all. Again, as Chuck said, I'm Carolyn Ridley. My company, TW Telecom, is a competing local exchange carrier, and we compete with AT&T, formerly Bell South, as well as other competing carriers for the business customers is our primary focus. Headquartered in Littleton, Colorado, but we serve 75 markets across 30 states. We're a very conservatively run company. Originally, we started off as a joint venture between Time Warner Cable and U.S. West. And U.S. West was a regional Bell operating company, as was the legacy Bell South. But with all the mergers and acquisitions that have gone on in the telecommunications industry, U.S. West is now part of Quest, which is now being bought by somebody else. In any event, this started in 1993. In 1997, a decision was made that we were going to focus on providing services to business customers, as I said, and it's voice services, both local and long distance, access to the internet, and data services. In 1998, Time Warner decided to spin us off, and we became a totally separate entity from Time Warner Cable. And then in 1999, we did our initial public offering, so we're now publicly on the NASDAQ. And right now, our stock is actually doing quite well, so we're proud of our company. In 2006, Time Warner sold off all their interests in our company, so we have no affiliation at all with a cable company at all. It was in our roots, but we have no interest they don't have any interest in our business. We've never provided cable TV. We've never provided video services. We are like a traditional telephone company, if you will. So like the legacy Bell South, now AT&T, those are the kinds of services that we deliver. We just deliver them to business customers. In Tennessee, since we started operating in Tennessee in 1996, we have a gross investment of over $83 million just in Tennessee. So we're not a fly-by-night. We're not a renegade. When we decide to do business in an area, we're very thoughtful about where we go. We have our salespeople have to provide us a business case that meets a certain return on investment. We don't have a philosophy of build it and they will come. We're trying to push through getting building permits because we have a customer in mind already that we're trying to meet some deadlines for, so that we were told this is the first step. It varies from municipality to municipality, obviously, so we're trying to abide by the rules, for telecommunications companies. And I'll stop with that. And if you all have any questions for me, I'm happy to answer them.
Well, I think, again, the goal is to, you know, what we have understand is that you can't, by law, can't charge a franchise fee for this type of product. You can for cable and other things. That was one of the concerns we had originally with the Time Warner thing, and we've done enough research and we're comfortable with that. I think they'll agree to say that's the only thing that they're providing under that.
Absolutely.
The rest of it is just trying to figure out some return on cost on using the right of way, mm-hmm. and we haven't got to that part yet, but I think that's where you want to leave it at this point in time and see if it's okay if we move forward with that. See if anybody has any objection to that.
Mm-hmm. None.
I want to know about the city incurs additional right of way right-of-way maintenance due to their usage, what would that entail? I mean, what are we talking about there? I mean, that's just a statement, but what does it entail?
Well, I think those are the final things we need to work out on
extensive, that, maybe.
Yeah, on that part of it. We need to develop a policy for actually usage of our right-of-way. That we haven't really done that. We probably need to work through this pretty quickly, and I think this gives us an opportunity to do that. And so, Chuck, if you wanted to comment,
I'd like to make
that,
a suggestion.
Please do.
And I wasn't going to do this, and I'm probably going to be sorry that I did.
We'll let you know.
But this gentleman, I'm sorry I didn't catch your name, but he hit the nail on the head.
That's why he gets the big bucks.
I can understand. Prior to 1997, there was no law on the books that would allow competition to Bell South in telephone service. We called it local exchange service. And so there wasn't any franchise. You know, you wanted Bell South there because if you didn't have them, you wouldn't have a telephone. Well, that's not the same thing. That's not the same history of the cable companies. About 1962, there was a federal act that created franchises and franchise fees up to 5%. So then we get into competition in telephone service, which started occurring about 1997, and a lot of the municipalities said, "Well, you know, these other companies are coming in; they're using our right of way. Let's do a franchise with them." Well, it just doesn't fit. And we've talked to Ms. Billingsley and provided some stuff to the mayor. It just doesn't fit. Now, this will develop over time, I'm sure, because we're getting into the same facilities, the same pipeline, that broadband you hear so much about, that delivers all the services. Somewhere along the line, we're going to deal with that, and it'll develop. But I would like to suggest to you, don't use a franchise agreement for this type of service. Maybe a right-of-way registration, and we can talk about fees that are necessary to cover the expense of building permits or construction permits, and attached to that a fee that is in the cases that we've looked at, is a fee for your supervision of these type companies' use of the right-of-way. But it's sort of a fee instead of a tax. Now the cable fee, franchise fee, if you will, is really a tax. It's just a percentage of gross income. It has nothing to do with the cost of the right of way. But that's permitted by federal law. But there's nothing in the law anywhere that permits the same type of fee for a telephone company.
In every other municipality in Tennessee where we're doing business, we pay permitting fees, and those are the fees that are used to recover the expense of managing the right of way. Once we're in the conduit, there's not really a whole lot of additional expense once we're in it. There are obviously concerns about companies who put fiber in and go bankrupt and their fiber's still in the ground and so forth. And there are some administrative expenses to say, who are you? Are you getting in our right of way? Once we open up the street, did you put the street back the way it's supposed to be? So there are some initial, I think, legitimate costs for the municipality to actually have a carrier go in their right of way. But those are covered in every other place we do business in Tennessee through a permitting fee. And I said I was happy to provide you all, David, with the costs that the permitting fees that we're using throughout the rest of Tennessee, just so you can have a benchmark. I'm actually, though, asking on bended knee or hat in hand or whatever, that whatever this process is, if it can be done expeditiously, because we actually do have a customer that we're trying to get the building permit for, and I'd hate to lose the business. We've made a decision to come into Franklin anyway, so we'd like to be able to work with you all. And actually, you know, it's an economic development kind of an issue. We're bringing competitive alternatives to the businesses here, so it's all good.
If we brought this back in 2 weeks and have something worked out, within your schedule? And so we'll bring it back on a work session and then on the BOMA meeting on whatever that date is, October, the second Tuesday in October. Okay?
Thank you.
All right.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Mike,
for hearing us.
We'll reconvene at 7 o'clock.